Okay. Okay, then we are ready for the second part on bootstrap. Okay.
Okay, so let's try to conclude this conformal bootstrap review. So we finished with this formula. Okay, let me just remind you what this formula means. So this came from analyzing the four-point function of, say, the simplest, the lowest dimension operator in the Ising model. In fact, everything I'm saying holds if you take a four-point function of the same operator. And we rewrote this crossing symmetry equation that was obtained by interchanging the points 1 and 3 using the conformal block expansion in this following way, where we have a sum over all operators O that appear in the OPE of sigma with sigma, okay? So this will be some sum of operators O, okay? We have to sum over all the operators except the identity. So the identity was like I massage this equation such that I put 1 on this side, so I remove the contribution of the identity to the right-hand side. But now this equation has this very nice form where you have a sum of positive coefficients, because unitarity imposes that lambdas are real, so they are a square of a real number. They are positive coefficients, times a function which is known, and it's kinematical. Okay? It only depends on the conformal block, so it's only a function of the dimensions of the operators delta and del, so these operators O that are being exchanged, scaling dimension and spin. And that's it. So now, what can this equation tell us about the spectrum of the theory and the OP coefficients, this lambda of the theory? Okay? Recall that what we're trying to do is to use these consistency conditions, so this would be one consistency condition, to impose constraints on the CFT data, which is the set of lambdas and deltas. Okay?
Excuse me.
Yes, where is that?
Oh, here. What do you mean by the sum over all the operators? Because, I mean, you listed some operators, but I guess...
All the operators that appear in the OPE of sigma with sigma. So it's all the operators in the theory. Well, they have to be even. And this. It's an infinite sum of operators. I just listed a few to have some...
Yes, but practically, how can you...
Good. So how do we work with this equation?
Yes.
So it's a functional equation and has infinite number of unknowns. Okay? How do we work with it? So the simplest trick is to use this strategy of linear functionals. So let me make this statement, which will be obvious. So if you can find an alpha, so a linear function alpha, such that, so choose a linear functional that acting on functions of u and v obeys the following property. So if it acts on the constant function 1, it's 1, okay? Actually, it's minus 1. Okay? This is a choice of normalization of your functional. And then you also choose that alpha, well, let me be a bit more explicit. Let me write here. So let me rewrite that sum for the Ising model. Okay. So let me rewrite this sum more explicitly for the Ising model. What is that sum? Well, let's just separate some operators. So, for example, there's a sum over scalar operators where you have lambda, sigma, sigma, and operators with some dimension delta and spin 0. Okay, and you have f of delta 0, uv, where, let's say, the scalars only must have dimension bigger than some parameter delta epsilon, or greater than equal to delta. Because delta epsilon was the scalar of lightest dimension, So we just impose delta epsilon as a parameter and say this sum can only run over operators which has dimension starting at delta epsilon all the way up to infinity. And then you have the sum over operators with non-trivial, non-zero spin, so from 2 to infinity. Recall that the spin has to be even because of the other Bose symmetry, permutation symmetry between 1 and 2. And for each one of these, you also have a sum over dimensions, lambda, sigma, sigma, delta L. Okay. So I'm parameterizing, instead of writing O, I just write the labels delta L. It's just some, it's not a very beautiful notation, but hope it's clear. And here you have delta L UV equal 1. So what do we know about this sum? So here is where the unitarity bounds enter. So because of unitarity, the dimensions of operators with non-zero spin has to be greater than d minus 2 plus L. Okay? So that's the dimension of a spin L conserved current, and that's the lowest possible dimension that you can have in a unitary theory. Okay? So this is a more explicit way of writing this sum, separating types of operators. And so now let me formulate the conditions of this linear function on these terms. So if it acts on the function f of scalars, okay, spin 0 and dimension delta, we want this to be positive, return equal to 0, for all delta greater or equal than delta epsilon. And we also impose that f of delta L also positive for all delta above the unitarity bound. Okay. If there exists such a linear functional, then well, let's say the theory is excluded. The spectrum assumption is excluded. Okay, is the statement clear? So if I have this linear functional, what do? I take my linear functional and I act on both sides of this equation, and I get a sum of positive things, right? So I get something positive. So I get something greater than 0 equals minus 1. Okay? So clearly, my assumption is incompatible with this constraint, if I can find such a functional. Is this clear? OK, so now I will stop being or trying to be pedagogical, and I will just tell you what you can get out of this. So what people do in practice is to use numerical algorithms to search for this type of linear functionals. So in practice, the linear functional, when it acts on a function of u and v, we choose a space of linear functions which is of this type. So you take a linear combination of derivatives with respect to u and derivatives with respect to v of the function at u equals v equals a quarter. Okay, that's a special value of the function, and you sum over a and b, say from 0 to some capital N. So these are the parameters of your linear functional, and then this is called a linear programming problem. So you want to search for parameters in this linear functional such that these conditions are satisfied. Okay. And okay, I won't say anything else about that. But it's clear that it's a well-defined mathematical problem. Okay. Now you can do it more optimized or less optimized. And if you really like that, I strongly invite you to come to this Bootstrap school. It's an entire week about Bootstrap. So think of my lectures as an appetizer for something more detailed. And you can also take the opportunity to come to São Paulo and enjoy very good food and very nice people.
Sorry. When you say you sum over all operators?
Yes.
And it's an infinite sum?
Yes.
It's all primary operators?
Here, yes, because the descendants are packed inside the conformal blocks.
Okay, so in your 3D model, you have an infinite tower of primary operators.
Yes.
And okay, and how do you know the primary operators of a few?
We don't know. We only know a few of the low-dimension ones. But you see, this method bypasses that, because I don't need to know exactly which operators are in that sum. If I just find this functional, which is positive for all these deltas above this value, okay, then it will be positive, whatever operators are actually there. Okay, so that was one of the main tricks that saved the day, that made this possible and practical. Any other question? Ah, good point. So this is, it's somehow natural. U equal a quarter corresponds to a square. Okay, you put the, so it's the most crossing, most symmetric configuration of 4 points. But it's not mandatory. Some people have generalized this to, instead of computing derivatives around this point, just compute this at separate points. What's important is that you want to go from a functional equation, so here it's true for all values of U and V, to some finite list of equations. So either by taking derivatives at some point or just evaluating at different points. Okay, so then let me just draw the plot of what you get out of that.
Does that influence the convergence, the point that you choose?
Yes. So the convergence of the conformal block expansion, it's better. It's like the OPE, so if you are closer in the respective OPE channel, if the 2 points are closer. Since here you're using both OPE expansions, one and the crossed one, this would be the fastest convergence. So this region is dominated by the low-dimension operators. The high-dimension operators give an exponentially small correction. But even if you do finite deformations, that's still true. Just the exponential decay, the constant that controls the exponential decay in delta will change, will depend precisely on the cross ratio at which you are. But it's still true that it's exponentially convergent. And in some cases, that might even be better, because if you want to be sensitive to slightly higher dimension operators, it's probably better to explore different kinematics. Okay, so...
Sorry. For this function, you still needed to know one primary operator, right? The sigma, at least?
Sure, right. So you are considering the four-point function of a given operator. But I'm also, as I'm showing in this plot, now what you can do, now it's just a mathematical problem. Delta sigma is one parameter. Delta epsilon is another parameter, okay? And you can just vary these two parameters and see if this mathematical problem has a solution or not, okay? Now it really doesn't know anything else about physics. It's just that. And if you do that, basically you will find that there is some curve, and you can exclude all theories here. So let me just put some numbers here. So we are in 3D, so the lightest dimension is a half for a free scalar. And if it's free in the OPE, you'll have sigma squared with dimension 1. Okay. And then here, this kink appears at 0.518 and whatever, 1.4. And this region is allowed. Okay, do you understand this picture? So at every point in delta epsilon, delta sigma, you try to find this linear functional. Here you can find it, so you exclude the theory. Here you cannot find it, so you cannot exclude the theory. There might be a theory here, there cannot be a theory here. Okay? And the remarkable thing is that this plot as a kink, as some feature, And it turns out that the Ising model lies precisely at this king, for reasons which are still not entirely understood. Okay, so this is, if you want, one of the earlier plots that gave life to this topic. But nowadays, what we can do is much better. So if instead of analyzing just the four-point function of the sigma field, if you analyze the four-point function of the sigma field, but also the correlation function of sigmas with epsilon, so these three four-point functions at the same time, okay? So now you see that bootstrap will be much more constraining because the same OP coefficients that appear, for example, here, sigma epsilon can go into epsilon. Sigma epsilon can go into sigma. And so that OP coefficient also appears here. Sigma sigma can go into epsilon. I mean, okay. You can analyze all of this together. You will get a more complicated set of equations. It's actually not just linear. It's more like quadratic programming. And then if you run this code SDPB, which is a code that David Simons Duffin developed precisely to efficiently look for this type of functionals, okay? Then let me just draw the picture if I can. So what happens is that if you zoom in here, okay? Zoom. Now it's like that. So if you draw, this is like what Monte Carlo error bar. Okay. Okay. So this is how precisely Monte Carlo simulations determine, let's say, delta epsilon and delta sigma, okay, in some scale. Now, if you run this code which imposes these conditions over this tree, you find that the only allowed region is something like that. Everything else is excluded, okay? So this is excluded. And only this interior of this tiny region, which you also almost cannot see, it's allowed. Okay, so this is just to give you an idea that actually this method that looks very abstract and very formal, in practice, it's now by far the most precise determination of the critical exponents of the 3D Ising model. Okay, and there's many other things that are happening now. People are studying other theories, I mean, ON theories with other global symmetries in different space-time dimensions. Bootstrapping four-point functions of currents, bootstrapping four-point function of stress-energy tensors. These are not yet finished, but these are ongoing projects that I know of, and hopefully they will be discussed in this school and in the workshop in São Paulo. And I think this is all I wanted to say about this review. Are there questions about this?
One question. So, given some values of lambdas which satisfy the consistency condition, does there always exist a CFT which has those lambdas?
So you're asking if the consistency conditions are
sufficient
for the existence of CFT? Probably not. Probably there are more consistency conditions that we're not imposing. So, for example, consistency of the theory in spaces with non-trivial topology. So just not just on RD, but in some spaces. So for example, in two dimensions, we know that we should also consider consistency on the theory on the torus. It's not enough to have correlation functions which are well-defined on the plane. There are extra conditions that come from the torus. So yeah, that's so far, not much has come out from these extra conditions. This is something that needs to be studied more. Yeah. Okay, so this is stop, new topic. So this is well developed. There's lots of things happening, but it's well-established subject out to bootstrap conformal field theories. Now what we want to do is to bootstrap, apply the same type of philosophy to quantum field theories, okay, to massive theories where you don't have conformal symmetry. So we will first approach that problem by considering the quantum field theory not in flat space, but in hyperbolic space. Or for string theorists, we call it anti-de Sitter space. Okay. So, and again, it's going to be, I will use D plus one dimensional anti-de Sitter space. So, but okay, don't get confused with ADS CFT, okay? There's no gravity at all. So ADS is just some fixed geometry, fixed background, and we're just gonna study a quantum field theory on this geometry. So what is the geometry? Okay, the geometry, so there's some radius of curvature, and the metric, I can write it in Poincaré coordinates, so it's dx mu dx mu over z square. Okay, so this x mu lives in Rd, so z, let me just plot it. Let's try to plot it here. So z goes from 0 to infinity. Z equals 0 is the conformal boundary of this space, and it's just conformally equivalent to Rd. Okay, so x mu will be the directions like that. You have some Rd at each value of z. Okay, so this is our space, the space above this plane, ADS d plus 1. Okay. And it will be convenient for us to also draw another picture, an equivalent picture of this space, which follows from the fact that you can write. Okay, let me write Rd not in Cartesian coordinates but in spherical coordinates. So let me call it dr square plus r square d omega d minus 1 square. Okay. So R would be like this radius here, and at each value of R, there's a sphere. Okay. Okay. And so what I will do, I will just move to global coordinates, and the transformation is very simple. I just have to write Z and R as e to the tau, and then this will be like cosine rho and sine rho. Okay, so in this picture it's actually very, very clear what is happening. So the constant tau surface is an hemisphere, something like that. Okay, this is the constant tau surface. I'd say tau equals zero, okay? And rho is this angle, rho. Goes from zero to pi over two and interpolates between z and r, okay? So if you do that, the metric becomes, what does it become? It's still r square, but now you get d tau square plus d rho square plus sine square rho d omega d minus 1 square over cosine square rho. Okay, so you can do that, it's a simple exercise. And in this picture, what we have is that now when rho equals pi over 2, it's the conformal boundary, and we see that the metric is just a metric, when rho equals pi over 2 is just a metric on a cylinder. Okay, so here we draw the picture. Okay, so tau is global time. Rho is a radial coordinate on this cylinder. So rho is like that. Rho equals 0 is the center. Rho equals 0. And the boundary is rho equals pi over 2, the conformal boundary. And if you draw, for example, this tau equals 0 surface, so this tau equals 0 surface is just something like that. Okay, so this central point, if I call it the point A, is this point here, point A. Okay, so this would also be the tau equals 0 surface. So at the tau equals 0 surface, you have an hyperbolic space with the radial coordinate rho, and at infinity, this is an S d minus 1. Okay, so the boundary is S d minus 1 times R, so the boundary of ABS. Okay. Any question about these pictures? Just so that we know what geometry we are in. Yes.
Does this cover the same patch of the geometry, or is it more extended?
So I'm doing everything Euclidean. Okay. So both coordinate systems cover everything. Okay. Maybe this point here gets mapped to tau equals minus infinity here. But. More questions?
Are you going to do quantum field theory in curved
space? Yes, quantum field theory in curved space time, exactly.
Standard.
There are books about it, yes, that's true. Exactly. Okay, good. So what do I want to do with this? So first thing to notice is that we have a symmetry group. Okay, so first thing to notice is the same thing that we do in ADS-CFT, but here again we just have this quantum field theory in a background geometry, but the isometry group of ADS, okay, so just the geometric symmetries, in this Euclidean signature is this Lorentz group, SOD plus 1, comma 1, which is exactly the same or isomorphic to the conformal group in D dimensions, okay, so for, let's say, for RD. Okay, so that's the first suggestion, that we might be able to study quantum field theory in AVS D plus 1 using the conformal symmetry in D dimensions, what we saw before. But actually, this correspondence can be made very precise. Okay, so let's consider observables in this theory. Okay, so what are the natural observables? Well, I can consider bulk operators. So let's consider a bulk operator phi that depends on z and x mu. Okay. So this is a bulk operator, bulk local operator. Okay. So for example, I don't know, maybe I can put it here, phi inserted at this point, for example, some local operator. And now the question is, what happens when I expand this operator close to the boundary? Okay, so I expand at small z. Okay, so I put this operator very close to the boundary. So let me tell you what happens. What happens is that you have a sum of terms, powers of z, okay, which have some power dependence. Let me call it delta O, okay, with some coefficients, AO, times operators which you can define exactly at the boundary. So they only depend on X mu. Okay, so this is just a series expansion. You will see, well, series, but it's a branch point behavior, so you can have non-integer powers of Z, But when you expand z, so this is z going to 0, you will have this sum of operators. And the higher the operator, the smaller the contribution. Okay. So in fact, this series also has a finite radius of convergence. Okay. And I didn't explain you before why the OPE is a finite radius of convergence. But let me try to explain you here why this. So this is what I would call a local bulk operator, local boundary operator. So it does not depend on z. It's inserted at the boundary. Okay. So the idea is that I'm expanding phi at some distance z by a sum of many operators inserted directly at the boundary at z equals 0. Okay. So why can I do this?
Just a question. Every point in the interior is infinitely far away from the boundary, right?
Yes, in terms of geodesic distance, yes, that's true.
So, okay, by distance here, you just mean the z-coordinate?
Z-coordinate. Okay. So why does this work? Because indeed, your comment suggests that this looks like a bit crazy. It's infinitely far away, so how can you expand? It just follows from these pictures. So let me see if I can convince you. What I will do is I will study this theory in quantization in terms of this tau coordinate. Okay, so in this cylinder, it's very natural. Think of this as your time. And now to each constant time surface, you have an associated Hilbert space of states. Okay, and the Hamiltonian evolves those states from one time to the next. Okay, so here you have. So this is what I will call bulk states, okay? Some Hilbert space of bulk states. Okay. So in this picture, what does that correspond to? Well, it's some funny quantization where you quantize in hemispheres. Those are your constant time surfaces. It's some generalization of radial quantization. Okay? You evolve these hemispheres, is what corresponds to evolving here in time. So in particular, the Hamiltonian here maps to the dilatation operator around that point, right? Because that just sizes the size of the sphere. Okay? The size of the sphere is e to the tau. Okay? So the statement I want to make is that there is a state operator map, so a one-to-one map between bulk states and boundary operators. Okay? So let me write that, and then I'll explain better. So bulk state, it's in one-to-one correspondence with boundary, okay, local boundary operators. So let's see how this map works. Suppose I have a state. How can I map a state to a local operator? So I take this state at some tau equals 0, and I evolve to the past using the Hamiltonian. Okay? So that's an isometry. It's completely regular. You won't find any singularity along the way. You can evolve all the way to t equals minus infinity. So what does this tell you in this picture? It means that you have some state here, and now you're shrinking it all the way to this point B, which corresponds here to t equals minus infinity. Okay? So it means that this state is mapped under backward time evolution to a local operator, to a local boundary condition on your path integral, if you want. Okay? So by definition, that's a local operator. So it doesn't affect anything at finite distance. It only affects the neighborhood of this point B. Okay? So that establishes the map in one direction. So what about the other direction? Given a local operator on the boundary, how do I prepare a state? Okay? So you just run the argument the other way. Okay? You insert a state B here. Sorry, you insert here an operator. And now you just do the usual argument conformal field theory. So you do the path integral inside this hemisphere with this insertion, and that creates some state on the boundary, right? You cut open the path integral, So the boundary condition to glue the outside with the inside is a state at the boundary. So if you put here some operator, this path integral inside the hemisphere is a linear map from the local operator to a boundary state. Okay. So if you have seen state operator map before, I think this will be clear. If you have not seen, probably this is too abstract. You have to sleep on it. But okay, I will assume that that it's clear. But I can answer questions if that helps. Any question? Okay, so once you have that, then it's clear that this expansion has a finite radius of convergence. Because you can do the same argument, you say, I put phi somewhere at some finite distance away, so that, by doing the path integral inside the sphere just with this phi, prepares some state, and then some state here can just be decomposed in eigenstates of the Hamiltonian, and each one of these eigenstates of the Hamiltonian is an eigenstate of the dilatation operator, so it's just some well-defined local operator inside that at the origin, right? Because all the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian must be inserted there, right? They're just scaling with the dilatation around the center of this hemisphere, okay? So in fact, this is a finite radius of convergence, and you should actually think of it as a definition of what a local boundary operator is, okay? So this is what you have when you have quantum field theory in AVS. You have bulk fields, or bulk local operators, and you look at them and their correlation functions, and then you just expand when they approach the boundary, and you read off what boundary operators do you have, okay? This is if you want the definition. And it's convenient to separate, like we did before, boundary operators by their symmetry properties. So, as I said before, you have this conformal group, which acts in ADS as the isometry, but acts on this boundary as the conformal group. So here, I can restrict to primaries. And again, sum here the descendants, like del square, O, with some coefficients. And all of these, by a similar argument, are fixed by conformal symmetry, okay? So this is exactly the same type of argument that we did for the conformal field theory, OP. We can always separate the primary from the descendants. And the descendants are fixed by symmetry. There's no new data. Okay? Is this clear?
I'm saying that there should be a non-normalizable mode also in ADS.
No, here... No.
Or this is just an off-shell argument?
This is a... No, the way it is, it's true inside any vacuum correlation function. Okay, so you can now use this OPE inside a correlator where you have many phis inserted in the bulk, but the boundary conditions are fixed to the trivial. No sources are turned on. Okay, so this is true in the set of correlators.
How do we know that this is not just a conformal field theory in disguise and this is something genuinely different from what we had already considered?
Good. Ask again if it's not clear. So the other thing that follows from this boundary, from this state operator map...
This O of X mu, these are operators in which theory?
Can you repeat?
The O.
Yes.
In which theory are these operators?
These operators are... in this quantum field theory in ADS. So they are operators. So this is the definition, okay? This is the definition of what they are. You take your quantum field theory in the bulk, and you just say, okay, so let me draw ADS
like a circle, you take insertions, phi, whatever, phi, at some z and some x, mu, and then you expand close to the boundary. Okay? And you read off the correlation functions of these operators, because you read off the powers at which this correlator decays, and what multiplies the powers is, by definition, the correlator functions of these boundary operators. So the logic, take the logic as I define an operator by its correlation functions. So I'm defining you for you. All the correlation functions of O are obtained by computing correlation functions of phis and then expanding. Okay? So this looks a bit formal, but then this argument really tells you that this expansion has a finite radius of convergence, because you can cut here these things and really do quantization. Shrinking this hemisphere is a symmetry, so you can really do quantization around this sphere, and let's say you go there to the center, and then a complete set of local operators there is just equivalent to a complete set of states there, and that's a finite expansion. You just have to expand. It's a Hilbert space decomposition in Huygens states of the Hamiltonian. Okay, but the same argument also tells you that these local boundary operators by themselves also have an OP, a convergent OP, right? Because I can also draw two operators. Suppose now I don't have a phi, I just have O here, let's say O1, and then O2 here. And again, this prepares some state, I can re-expand it. So this also implies that convergent OPE for boundary operators, okay, for O's, for boundary operators. Okay? So the statement is that with this construction, we can focus on a subset of observables. Okay, so take observables on this quantum field theory in ADS to be correlation functions of these boundary operators. Okay, so this is just a subset. Of course, there are more observables in this quantum field theory in ADS, but these ones also exist. I just defined it. Yes.
You said that you don't have gravity, but I'm confused with the fact that you have the S-terrace tensor, which is corresponding to a spin-2 operator in the bulk.
You have a local stress tensor here in the bulk, right? Because it's some quantum field theory, so there is some T mu nu of Z and X, right? But when you take this operator and expand it close to the boundary, it does not produce for you a T mu nu of X. It does not produce for you a boundary stress tensor. There is only bulk stress tensor. Okay? So that's what I was trying to summarize here. So we take this observable, so it's a subset. It's not all the observables in your quantum field theory in ADS. And what do we know about them? Well, we know that they enjoy conformal symmetry just from the geometry. We know that they enjoy a convergent OPE. Okay, so, or if you want, an associative convergent and associative OPE. We also know, now it depends, if we start from a quantum field theory in ADS, which is unitary, like a quantum field theory that has a good Lorentzian rotation, then this will also be unitary, okay? And the only thing that is failing is that there is no stress tensor, T mu nu of X, okay? No boundary stress tensor. Boundary operator, okay? Is this clear? Let me see if I'm saying everything I want to say.
Sorry, what exactly fails when you take the bulk stress tensor to the boundary, why don't you get an actual stress tensor?
Why don't you get an actual stress tensor? Good, so the best way to see it, well, one thing I could tell is why would I? Because it's on you to show that I have. But the best way to see that it cannot is just to think about energy conservation. So this stress tensor is a bulk stress tensor, so it tells you that energy in the bulk is conserved. So if you have a boundary stress tensor, it means that energy in the boundary is conserved, so it cannot, for example, flow to the bulk. It's always on the boundary because the divergence on the boundary is zero. So it's really a different thing. So this stress tensor allows you, for example, you could even imagine that you have a theory where you have some degrees of freedom at the boundary and some at the bulk, and they can interchange energy, right? And so the conservation of the bulk stress tensor will have some delta function at the boundary that would tell you that you can exchange some energy with the boundary degrees of freedom. But that's different from having a stress tensor at the boundary, which is exactly conserved at the boundary.
Sorry, but so usually when you have curved spaces and you just pick a slice of it, which is basically what you're telling me, what you're doing here, the induced stress tensor is conserved respect to the induced metric. That
the induced stress tensor.
So since this is a curved space, the stress tensor will not be conserved under the normal derivative, but under the
sure. It's conserved under the covariant derivative. Yes.
And the induced one in the boundary should be conserved under the covariant derivative with the induced metric in the boundary, right?
Sure, but that's a different question.
In this case, it's a sphere.
That's fine, but you can also do it here, and it would be flat space. But that's a different question. Exactly how you write conservation. But what I'm saying is that it's one thing is to be conserved on the boundary, another thing is to be conserved on the bulk. Another way of saying it is that this is just quantum field theory. Okay, so the Hamiltonian will be an integral over an entire space-like surface of some energy density of T00. Okay, so it will be an integral over this entire surface here. Right? It will not be an integral just over the boundary. Okay, so the Hamiltonian in the CFT, it's just an integral over the boundary. That's the space where the CFT lives. Here, we don't have that. We have an Hamiltonian, which is an integral over the full space-like surface. So it's literally a different beast. There's no local conformal field theory. There's just a set of observables which satisfy almost all the properties that we wanted, but not this one.
In quantum field theory in a flat space time, the Noether current of the isometries, which is the Poincare group, is the stress energy tensor. So what's the Noether current of the isometric group in this case?
Sorry, can you repeat the question? Sorry.
So there is an isometry group. There is this group of symmetries on acting on this quantum field theory. So it must have a Noether current, right?
Sure. So the stress tensor is still conserved. Now, to form symmetries, you contract the stress tensor with killing vectors. So it's the killing vectors that depend on the geometry. Here, it's going to be the killing vector associated with this isometry group of ADS, and not the killing vectors of flat space-time. But the stress tensor is just conserved the same way, well with covariant derivatives.
Okay. So what do you mean by no stress tensor in one of the conditions? Like, why is it? Other than the fact that it's on ADS, it should be, everything else should be the same.
That's okay. That's what I'm trying to emphasize. On the boundary, okay? There is a T mu nu in the bulk, but there is no boundary operator, okay? It's only of X, okay? Okay. Sure.
Okay, so this implies somehow that you evolve boundary operators by the bulk Hamiltonian, right? In tau. If you want to have one of these boundary operators at another time, you evolve it with the full Hamiltonian of the bulk theory
yes.
in your description.
Yes.
And this is still a boundary operator, or is going to be a mix of boundary and bulk fields when you evolve? Because usually in ADS, you don't...
So you can evolve both boundary and... you can evolve both boundary and bulk operators by conjugating with e to the it, yes, the Hamiltonian. But the statement is that the Hamiltonian, okay, maybe I should write, the Hamiltonian is an integral over, for example, over this entire surface, okay?
Yes.
Let's say sigma. So it's a d-dimensional integral, okay, of some, let's say, some t zero zero or something. Okay, z and d d minus one x, z and x, okay, for example. Something like that. Suppose you evolve like that. Okay, sorry. For this picture, I cannot do that. Okay, d rho d omega. Okay, t zero zero. Okay, schematically. Okay, so the point is that there is a d rho. It's not just an integral over the boundary. Okay. So now we put the two things together. So now, quantum field theory in ADS, at least, contains a subset of observables which satisfy all the constituency, or almost all the constituency conditions of conformal field theory. So we can apply exactly the same machinery to find bounds and study the space of the OP coefficients that exist in between these boundary operators and the scaling dimensions of these boundary operators. Okay? So we can use the same machinery to obtain the, if you want, the CFT data, or okay, so let's say here, it's not a CFT, it's not a field theory, it's a conformal theory in d dimensions data. It's still the same, it's still the set of scaling dimensions of boundary operators and OP coefficients between boundary operators. Okay, that's what we will study. But who cares about that? Why should we study that? I wanted to study quantum field theory in flat space, okay? So you should complain, right? I wanted to find this, map out the space of quantum field theories, and now, okay, I cannot do it, so I go to ADS. It's a bit of a fake. So the question is, if I know that, how to extract flat space data or physics. Okay? So suppose I know that data, the set of scaling dimensions and the set of slope coefficients, can I get the actual data information about this quantum field theory in flat space time instead of ADS? Okay? So the answer is yes, and I'm super behind schedule, so let me first discuss the simple thing, which is the mass spectrum. That's very simple. So suppose you know the dimensions of these local operators, local boundary operators. Okay, so in this picture, I'm getting a bit messy. So in this picture, we saw that dilatation was dilatation operator around the boundary maps to the Hamiltonian in this cylinder. It's just translation in the coordinate tau. So in particular, we saw that the eigenvalues of the Hamiltonian, which are some energies, okay, are the same as the eigenvalues of the dilatation operator. But that's precisely what we call scaling dimension, okay, of boundary operator. So the scaling dimension maps to the energy of the state. Okay, if you want units, it's going to be delta over r. OK,
Okay.
Set by the radius of curvature of ADS. Okay, so this is exactly the same as in standard ADS CFT. But once you know that, you see, knowing the CFT data, at least this part, the spectrum of scaling dimensions, tells you the energy spectrum of your quantum field theory in this cylinder. Okay. So if you know the energy spectrum of a quantum field theory in a box, you know the energy spectrum of a quantum field theory in flat space. You just have to make the size of the box very big, and you just see the energy levels converging to what flat space gives you. Okay? So in particular, if you just take ratios, if you want to know ratios of masses in flat space, you just have to take ratios of scaling dimensions. Okay? And what does it mean to make the size of the box very large? Well, it means that the energy of the state is much larger than 1 over the size of the box, right? That's what it means to be in a very big box. It means that your Compton wavelength is much shorter than the size of the box, okay? So for example, from this equation here, you know that if you just have a mass, a particle of mass m, okay, what you will get that will correspond to a scaling dimension, which is m times r. Okay? So energy of a particle of mass m at rest is m, so if you multiply by r, you just get delta. Okay? So the point is that the limit where the size of the box becomes very large is the limit where all scaling dimensions go to infinity with fixed ratios. And the ratios are ratios of masses in flat space. Okay. This is very simple, so I'm afraid I was not clear, but it's really extremely simple if you know. This is just a box, but it's a very symmetric box. So if you put here a particle of mass m, its energy is approximately m. You compute the dimension corresponding to that state is m times r, now in the limit where the r is much bigger than 1 over m, which is the Compton wavelength. It means delta goes to infinity. And of course, if you take ratios, r cancels, so this formula comes out. Okay? Yeah, let me finish this. So the other thing that you might want to calculate is what's called scattering amplitudes. And there is some nice formula.
Can I just ask one question?
Sure.
Typically, you have a finite spectrum, say, in the quantum field theory. Right?
Yeah.
But you have infinite number of operators, local operators. So do all of them give the same mass? Or many of them give the same mass?
Good. So yeah, okay. There's one argument which I forgot to mention. So what's the difference between a primary and a descendant? Right? So what is a primary? What does it mean to be a primary operator here? What type of state is that? And what type of state is a descendant? So if you have a primary operator, that creates for you a state which doesn't have center of mass motion. Okay? So a descendant is just a boosted version of a primary. So of course, it's in ADS, so the boosts are achieved by the generator P mu in the standard conformal algebra. But exactly like... I'm making a mess. Good. So let's do it properly. So we have primary operator O, and then we have descendants, which are derivatives acting on O, or you can think of it as the generator of translation P mu acting on O. So what happens in terms of states, it's exactly the same thing. So here you will have some state O, which is a special state, so it's because it's a primary, it's annihilated by some of the generators. And the other ones are just boosted versions, so you act with symmetries on O, and in particular, the Hamiltonian, so the energy of this state is just the energy of this plus the number of p's that you act. So this corresponds to discrete boosts. So intuitively, you should think that you can actually study the wave functions. So I'm making a mess. Let me write here. So if you take your cylinder, the wave function of the primary will be some nice, bump function centered around the origin. And now, so it corresponds to a particle just sitting at rest for all times. And now if you act with PMU, you create a descendant. It means that at some time, you kind of give it a small boost. So you get some waves that make the function make it do like that. So this would be the semi-classical description. This would be the primary. And this would be the descendant in terms of, let's say, where the maximum of the wave function is at a given time. Okay, so that's one thing we should focus on, primaries, right? Because descendants are just boosted versions, so it's like having a particle at rest and the boosted version of the particle. Of course, these are new states, gives you a continuous spectrum, but it's trivial. We will drop that. We only look at primaries because center of mass is at rest. Now you still want to, you want to know about the spectrum.
Multi-particle states?
Multi-particle states, yes. Exactly. So now multi-particle states. So let's look at the energy. Energy, okay? We are inside a box. Let's put energy times R, for example. No, let's put energy, it's okay. So vacuum, then let's say there's one particle state M, okay? And now there's a two-particle state, it would be 2M, but since it's inside a box, it's probably 2m plus some small kinetic energy. And then this two-particle state can be in many modes. So you will get lots of, so 2m plus integers, right? 2m plus 2, 2m plus 4. And actually, this is, then you also have spin. You can put the two particles rotating around each other, okay? So all these two-particle states, okay, let's say this is spin zero. Then you have the same here for with two particle states. You can make orbital spin two, okay, and all like that. So all of this, now as you take the large radius limit, what do you see? You see the state, which is the single particle, and then you see a continuum, which is the two particle continuum. Okay, so if this deltas are inside the continuum, you should really think of these ratios of masses as more ratios of energies. It's not. It's like the invariant mass square of a two-particle state, if you want. But I'm more worried about having, I'm focusing on having here some other M prime and ratios of these stable masses, which are below the two-particle cut, then they will obey this property. Is this clear? Okay, so I will skip here the most of the discussion, which would have to go through Malin amplitudes.
And can you also see resonances?
Yes, I think yes. So a resonance would be, you would have an extra state here, right? An extra state inside this, instead of having just what you expect from a two-particle state, you have something extra. And so the levels here, due to interactions, will reorganize a bit.
And somehow it should have an imaginary part.
Yes. Actually, one of the formulas would make that kind of more explicit. Maybe I can write that formula and we discuss in the beginning of next lecture. I have to improvise. Maybe I stop, and then I write during the 5-minute break like two or three formulas, and then I just quickly start next hour. Okay, let's stop then. Thank you.